I, of course, want to begin by thanking Leslie for organizing this event. It's a fantastic idea. And I also want to give kudos to Wes Savick and his collaborators, who dedicated many months getting to know Henry and then sort of seeping into his brain so that they could understand what he felt like when he said, "You see, I don't remember things." Speaking of Henry's brain, I'm going to show you Henry's brain. Could you turn down the lights just a little bit, please? Thanks. Okay, so this is an MRI scan, and it's a horizontal section through his brain. So imagine that my brain is sliced from front to back like that. Oops. And in this kind of imaging, the bright white signal is actually cerebrospinal fluid. It's where fluid is and brain isn't, where brain used to be in many cases. So in the top three sections, A, B, and C, you see in the back of his brain here that his cerebellum is very badly atrophied, shrunken. And that's not because of the operation, it's because he took Dilantin, large doses of Dilantin, for many years. That's an anti-seizure medication. But more importantly, in C, D, and E, you see his lesion in the temporal lobe, in both temporal lobes. This is the left side and this is the right side, and the damage extended 5.4 centimeters back from the tip of the temporal lobe on the left side and 5.1 on the right side. And what Bob just referred to is that Scoble actually estimated that the extent of the lesion was 8 centimeters, so he greatly overestimated how much tissue he took out, and only with the advent of MRI could we get a more accurate idea of what his lesion actually was. Now, the night that HM died, Hearst brought his body to the Mass General Martino Center, and we scanned him for 9 hours. And what I'm going to show you now is a little movie showing you the images in one particular scan in a 3 Tesla magnet. And these images go from front to back. So imagine that you're looking at the front of my brain and just sort of progressing back to the back of my brain. Starting in the front, there are his eyes, nose, coming into the frontal lobes now, proceeding back. His ventricles, the spaces in the brain, are large. The lesion comes here, these large black areas. You can see that his corpus callosum is thin. Now we're moving farther back in the brain. The ventricles are still big. And in the back, we get to the cerebellum again, this shriveled structure that I showed you in the other slide. Now I'm going to show you pictures of HM's actual brain, the fresh brain right after the autopsy. And if you're squeamish, I suggest that maybe you admire the nice light fixtures in the ceiling for a few minutes and then come back again. So this is the fresh brain, as I said, right after autopsy. This is the front of the brain. This is the back of the brain. Here you see the olfactory bulb on one side, the olfactory tracts, the optic chiasm, and in the back, his shriveled cerebellum. This should come out farther on each side and also farther in back. These are the tips of the temporal lobes here and here. You can see the lesion here. It begins just after the tip of the temporal lobe and progresses back to blood vessel, a landmark, right here, to about here. And we think that the surgeon maybe deliberately stopped just short of that blood vessel so that he didn't cut it and cause more damage. Similarly, on the left side, this is the tip of the temporal lobe. The lesion extends back here, probably to about this blood vessel as well. Am I okay for time?
Yes.
Okay, just a close up now. This is the left side. Again, the front of the brain, the olfactory tract, the temporal lobe, and the lesion coming back here, stopping around here, and the same on the other side. Sorry, I'm